Welcome to Internet TCI, our monthly program where we discuss the global internet. My name is Rich Wiggins, and I'm speaking to you today from East Lansing, Michigan. As usual, I'd like to introduce my partner in crime, Chuck Severance.
Thanks, Rich. I think we got a really neat show planned for tonight. Our theme is sort of going to be alternate ways of communicating on the internet. We talk about net news and the World Wide Web and email and all the traditional things that the internet has been doing. But we're going to talk about some more experimental things, moving video and images and doing computer conferencing across the net. In each of the segments, in Internet for Everyone, we're going to talk about Netscape and actually how to use it. We've been using Netscape on all the shows now, and we're going to talk a little bit about what each of the buttons on Netscape does and what you can use it for. In the On the Road segment, for the first time, we're virtually going to go on the road, and Rich is going to use the program called See You, See Me to talk to Kevin Hughes of EIT over the Internet in real time, and I think that's real exciting. Another real-time thing that we're going to do is a program called M-Bone. And in Tech Talk, I'm going to talk about using multicast across the internet. That's where, instead of two people talking, you have a single broadcast with many people listening. And a nifty example that I saw that we'll show you later is the docking between the space station Mir and United States' space shuttle that happened this morning on the taping. And we'll show you some of that. It's real exciting stuff. As always, we'll have our net news segment. Our internet interview is with Jim Isaac at Digital Equipment Corporation, and he talks more on the national information infrastructure with us. And then we'll close with net surfing as we usually do. So, Rich, what are some of the things you've run across this month on the internet?
Well, Chuck, as usual, there's all kinds of things going on internet-wise. One of them that was kind of neat was I got email from a couple of folks that were bragging about something that they thought perhaps our group had been involved with. Turns out somebody who works for you was involved with it. This was something that was featured in Business Week magazine, and this is an article called Picking Through the Web Clutter. And in this article, they list the 10 favorite places on the whole global World Wide Web where people might want to go. And one of them is a weather-related site, and that site happens to be at Michigan State University. It says, of the many sites offering meteorological data, my favorite is the Michigan State University Weather Server. Well, guess what? That was put together by your employee, Charles Henrich.
Yep.
And he started working on that a couple of weeks after I told him about this thing called NCSA Mosaic back in March of 1993. And I remember very well when he told me, Mosaic, this is terrible stuff.
Right.
But he changed his mind and he produced one of the most popular things on the global internet.
And we're very proud of that.
It's good stuff.
Yeah.
Now, I've been off to three library conferences in the last month. And when I was flying off to one in Montreal, I took along with me a copy of Esquire magazine. And, you know, I'm looking for the weirdest place that you're ever going to run into URLs. And I'm flipping through Esquire magazine, and lo and behold, in a column that they call Reality Check, they have sort of a subcolumn, Virtual Reality Check, and they list a bunch of URLs. And in this case, they're talking about the O.J. Simpson case.
Okay.
All the things you can find on the World Wide Web about the O.J. Simpson case. So last weekend, I was off at my third of these library conferences. This was the American Library Association meeting in Chicago. And these are the credentials I picked up while I was there. And Chuck, I've skunked you, if you don't mind. I claim for this TV show to be the first of the two hosts to get a real press ribbon on my credentials. So you're going to have to go off and do that elsewhere.
I admit you thought of that first.
Okay.
Yep.
And I have a little quiz for you about this credential that I have. On the back of it, they have this odd-looking little grid here. And I wonder if you can figure out what this grid is all about.
Well, usually they give you a little... I bet somehow on there's your name and address. Somehow.
Well, Chuck, you're exactly right. I'm impressed.
The same as the little credit card things they always give you?
It's similar. This is an example of what people refer to as digital paper. And what they do is, when you're interested in something in a particular booth, they take the badge out, and they run this through a particular device that knows how to read that. It gets your name, address, and so forth. And then they mail you product literature. And it's an example of digital paper. It doesn't have anything to do with the internet, but I think it's
kind of cool. You can encrypt data in many ways. Data comes in many forms.
That's right. You can do that.
Wow.
So, Chuck, what have you found on the net this month that seems kind of interesting to you?
Well, one of my hobbies is producing stuff on the net. And the Internet TCI page, I slave over this thing and add things to it. And one of the things that we did is we took some real fancy equipment and made some MPEGs and QuickTime animations of the show and took little clips of the show. So I want to show a little clip of the show This is a QuickTime clip, and you can download this over the internet. This is the show. This is the clip of the first moments of the first show of, and guess who it is?
Hello. Welcome to Internet TCI, a monthly program where we explore the global internet. My name is Rich Wiggins, and I'm speaking to you tonight from East Lansing, Michigan. I'd like to introduce you to my partner, Chuck Severance.
Thanks, Rich. As Rich said, my name is Charles Severance, and I'm your other host for Internet TCI. Part of the reason that we're doing this show is that my esteemed colleague, Rich, has written a book on the internet. There are many books on the internet. One of the hobbies that you get once you've written a book on the internet is you go to bookstores all over the country and see if they're in there. And this book is in the bookstores, and that's pretty good. So the name of the book is Internet for Everyone, A Guide for Users and Providers, and it's written by Rich Wiggins. So other than our homepage, do you have if you had to take one homepage the whole month that you run across this month that is your favorite homepage?
One page out of the many, many homepages.
I know it's tough. What's one page?
Southwest Airlines is doing some cool stuff.
Let's go take a look. Tell us about Southwest.
Well, Southwest Airlines has been the envy of a lot of other airlines in terms of effective low-cost fares and competition and so forth. One of the things they've done for a number of years is they've had you call in their 800 number instead of participating in the global normal reservation system. And now they're sort of sidestepping the whole issue by providing direct internet access to their reservation system. And this is what their homepage looks like. They had to use one of these fancy image maps, and this is a rather large image map. And let's maybe pretend we're going to go and reserve some tickets here.
Walk, 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 walk. Okay, we're up here. This is sort of a virtual reality interface. You sort of pretend you're, I just guess that you're supposed to do this to buy a ticket. And there we are. Let's see.
And lo and behold.
Let's buy a ticket from Burbank. Someday we'll be in Hollywood. To Austin.
Oh, yeah, like Hugh Grant, right?
Hugh? You'll be in Hollywood, not Hugh. Submit. Who's Hugh Grant?
Who's Hugh Grant? He doesn't even. So you've told you want to buy that ticket?
Yep, I want to buy a ticket from Burbank to Austin. And away we're going, sending the request across the web. And here we cut the response back.
Pretty neat stuff.
So this is what this is showing, I think, is...
And you know what's really neat about this is you don't have to join an information utility. You don't have to buy into somebody's service. Get internet access, and you can plug into this and do commerce on the net, find out the right schedule, find out the right fare, buy your ticket. All over the internet.
Right. Here, if you click here on unrestricted anytime, it actually tells you what that means. Of course, that one's not a very good example. Let's click on something like it's unrestricted. A fun fare. What exactly does that mean? You have to keep asking the travel agent. Here in Netscape, all we have to do is click. It says one way, seats are limited, 14-day advance, must be purchased within one day, and it's non-refundable. I think that's pretty neat.
Pretty neat. Well, Southwest Airlines takes us to a certain level of atmosphere. Maybe we want to go a little bit higher above the Earth.
Yeah, my favorite page was the orbit page of the NASA shuttle.
Okay.
And they put quite some fancy equipment up to support all this stuff. We can actually look at some of the real-time information over the web as to what's going on. I'll click here on tracking, and we'll take a look at what is actually being shown on the big display at any given moment. They take a snapshot of this every once in a while. They take a snapshot and show us what's on the display. Let's take a second here. Let me try it again.
Ah, the fickle net. There we go.
There we go. So this is what's showing at any given moment on the display, and they periodically take another snapshot of this. So I think this is pretty interesting. It just allows scientists or students or people from around the world. Certainly this mission, being a Russian-United States joint mission, has got a worldwide view, and I think it's a neat concept. So that's my favorite page for the month.
Cool stuff.
So I guess that's the end of the intro, and we'll get on to the rest of the show.
Okay, let's get going.
Okay. In our Internet for Everyone segment tonight, Rich is going to tell us a little bit about Netscape. We use Netscape on every show, and it's actually a very powerful and flexible product. And Rich is going to show us some of the things that we can do with Netscape tonight.
That's right, Chuck. Netscape is an incredibly popular browser for surfing the World Wide Web, and since we use it in a lot of examples, we think it's important to tell people what some of the features are. So let's take a look. The Netscape Navigator, which is the proper term for this software, is offered by Netscape Communications Corporation. And in a lot of ways, it's the heir to the original NCSA Mosaic, because Mark Andreessen and Eric Bina and folks like that that were the original developers are now off in California working at Netscape Communications Corporation. Server surveys have shown that Netscape Navigator has about 75% of the market. So folks who are clicking out there tend to be using Netscape. It's not the only web browser that's out there, though, and it's important for people to understand that. There's the original Mosaic from NCSA, which is continuing to be enhanced. There is, of course, Netscape. But there are lots of other browsers, like America Online's web browser and Prodigy's web browser and so forth. Now, these different web browsers are able to talk to a variety of different kinds of servers, as we saw in last month's episode. You can go off to a World Wide Web server, you can go to a Gopher server, an FTP server, and there are lots of other kinds of resources that you can access. So this one tool can be a sort of an all-purpose appliance to let you do all kinds of things. If we wanted to go off to a particular location, we're going to deal with something that's called a URL, or a Uniform Resource Locator. Here's an example of one of those. They're always going to begin with http://, and then they'll have the address of a particular place on the net we're going off to. Sometimes they will optionally have some other information, as we'll see in a second here. Now, since they all begin with HTTP, it's useful to review what that means. HTTP stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol, and that's the set of rules that govern how documents are moved from a server somewhere on the net off to a user's workstation somewhere on the net. Now, the documents that are moved, in the case of native web documents, are all going to be in the hypertext markup language, or HTML. So let's go through a couple of definitions in review here, and then we'll launch into our discussion of Netscape. One of these URLs is what we're going to use as we're going to go and grab something on the net. It's the unique name we use to reference a resource on the World Wide Web. A home page is the beginning of a particular web document or a collection of documents somewhere on the net. A web browser is simply a tool like Netscape. It's a program you use to navigate the web. Now, these web browsers, including Netscape, will often use tools that are called helper applications. These are programs that will help the web browser either display, or perhaps in the case of sound, play a particular file. Okay? And when we're surfing the net and we're using these URLs, we're going to have three different parts to them. We're going to have the beginning part, which is the protocol, http://. We're going to have the address of a server somewhere on the net. And then optionally, we're going to have a path to a specific document that resides on that server. Let's look at what the main screen of Netscape looks like and sort of look at the landscape of the Netscape browser. First off, at the very top of the screen, we always see the title for the document that we're currently looking at. Then below that, we'll have a series of options that are standard for Windows or Macintosh or whatever windowing environment you're using for selecting different options. But we also have some nice toolbar options that are sort of shortcuts to help us jump our way straight into particular applications. We'll see what those shortcuts are like in a second here. We have a location bar that tells us specifically where we are. It's the location of the current URL of the document that we're looking at on screen. And we have some directory buttons. These buttons are sort of very quick shortcuts to jump to some locations that the Netscape people think might be useful. For instance, they have a list of the places they think are cool on the net, and click on what's cool, and poof, you're off to that location. Even the logo is sort of a little shortcut directory hop. If you click on this little N here, you'll find you jump straight off to the home page of the Netscape company. Now, within this area, we have the actual home page or whatever page we're looking at. So that's sort of the client area or document area. And we have a scroll bar that we can use to go up and down within that document. The toolbar that I talked about a second ago has the following options. You have a back key that'll let you go back to a previous document that you just visited. And if you've hopped forward looking at some stuff and then back one level, there's a forward key that becomes active. That lets you revisit the place that you just came back from. Now, occasionally when you're surfing the web, you find you get lost. You want to go home. There's a home key that'll let you jump straight back to what's been configured as your default home page. Sometimes when you're surfing, things get a little bit screwed up on your screen, something goes wrong, and you need to reload the current page. Click here and that'll happen. There's an option in Netscape that lets you defer the downloading of inline images. If you've selected that option, you can click on the Images key and it'll go get those images for you. If you want to jump to a particular URL in the net, click on the Open button and it'll prompt you for the place you want to go to. And of course, sometimes you want to print things for offline viewing, click here and that'll happen. Oftentimes, when you're looking at a big page, it's useful to be able to surf through that page and find something specific you're looking for. Click on the Find button to do that. Finally, we have the Stop button. This is often useful when you're pulling down a document over a server link that for some reason is slow. If things aren't coming through to your satisfaction, click on Stop and it'll interrupt the transmission. Now, when you want to jump off to a new URL, you can either click on that Open button I was talking about and it'll ask you for a location, or you can even go up to the top of the screen where it says Location and simply type over the current location and it becomes a go-to. Just hit Enter and poof, you'll jump off to that particular spot on the web. Let me go quickly through some of the different menu items that are available in Netscape. The File menu offers a lot of the different choices that are out there on the toolbar. You can open a file as well, and that means opening an HTML document that's local on your hard disk. You can also save the current document in HTML format if you want to do other things with it, and there are close and exit functions as well. There's an Edit menu that lets you do things like cut, copy, and paste, but of course you can do that sort of stuff with the operating system commands, such as Control-C in Windows. This is really useful if you want to grab a piece of text from your current document that you're looking at and paste it off into some other application. Okay? It's also useful if you want to be able to grab a URL from, say, an email message and paste it into Netscape to tell it where you want to go. There's a View menu, which has Reload and Redraw options, and then it has a useful option if you're trying to learn about HTML. Click on View Source, and you can see the source of the current document you're looking at. The Go menu lets you go back and forward, just as the toolbar buttons do, or jump to the default home page. This is also useful if you want to view a list of all of the URLs you visited in the current session, or quickly look at the list of the last several places you've visited most recently. There's a Bookmarks menu. This is real useful across time as you're doing a lot of surfing on the net. It lets you add a permanent item to this permanent list of URLs that are sort of your favorite places to go. And you can jump immediately to any one of those locations. You can also annotate those items. You can say, this is what's useful about this particular resource. The Options and Preferences menu has all kinds of options in it. You can control all kinds of aspects of Netscape. You can tell it what the default home page should be. You can talk about the layout of the screen. You can say how long you want your visited links to stay purple. You can configure what servers you're connecting off to. You can even choose what font size you want to have on the screen. If your vision is getting a little bad and you need a larger font, Netscape is most accommodating in this regard. You can tell it how much space you want it to devote to something that's called cache. Cache is very useful because it keeps up local copies of the places that you visit, and it saves going out to the network every time you revisit a popular page. It even lets you configure what helper applications to launch when you pull down a document of a particular file type. The Directory menu lets you jump to some special sites, much like the Directory buttons options let you do. And it also, besides the What's New and What's Cool and search options, has a few more places that you can visit. Okay? So now that we've gone over this in overview, let's go and do a little bit of looking around at Netscape. This is what it looks like on the screen, and I particularly want to call people's attention to the Options menu. When you look at the Preferences option under this, you'll have a little pick list, and you can go through and select all these different categories, which we've already talked about, for things that you need to be able to change, okay? And finally, Chuck, I want to show you a feature in Netscape that I bet you didn't know was there.
I'd be surprised.
Give me a URL.
http://...
How about WXWeb?
Oh, okay.
.msu.edu?
You got me.
I'm going to hit Enter. And you notice I didn't type http://.
You got me.
The current version of Netscape has finally gotten smart enough to go and insert that when it makes sense. And they made a liar out of me. I go around and I tell people how Tim Berners-Lee, the inventor of the World Wide Web, is responsible for making millions of people always type http://. Well, we don't have to do it anymore. Netscape's smart enough to figure it out.
Well, they're in business to make profit. One thing I'd like to call people's attention to that you didn't cover is on this options menu, when your screen, and we use this a lot on the show, when your screen is, screen size is small, because we try to make things as big as possible for people to see them, you can actually turn things off, you know, so I can turn off the showing of the directory buttons, and you'll notice I've saved some space. I can turn off the showing of the location or the toolbar, okay? And what we do is we try to make it so that you use as much as little space for the toolbar and stuff so that we can have as much space for the viewing when we set things up. But I like the configuration of that because you can, it can look like a lot of different viewers to you.
There's one more item we ought to mention, and that is as you put the cursor on particular hot links that you could click on, look at what happens at the bottom of the window. It shows you the URL of where you're going to go when you click on that location. So these are some of the features in Netscape. It gives you some flavor of the kinds of things you can do with it. There are more features that we'll cover in other segments in future episodes. In tonight's Chuck and Rich on the Road segment, we're going to have an interview conducted over the internet. And this interview was conducted with me in Ann Arbor, Michigan. And our correspondent, our person that we're interviewing, is out in Palo Alto, California. Before we get into that segment, I want to carry on with our tradition of whoever goes on the road needs to bring something back for the other guy. And when I was off in Montreal at the Special Libraries Association meeting, I got an artifact for you, Chuck, and I want to hold it up for the camera. Can we pick this up on camera?
What?
And then I want to hand it to you, and you got to tell me what this thing is.
Well, I'll tell you. I got the it's an IEEE Computer Society thing. But I don't have any idea what it is.
It looks like some sort of a dental.
Open your mouth up and check to see if your teeth are okay.
Well, Chuck,
what is this?
This is doubly appropriate for Chuck because it is a bookmark, and it's from IEEE, and Chuck is a member of an IEEE committee that's called POSIX, and Chuck is also a contributing editor for IEEE Computer Magazine. But most importantly, you can put that on page 410 of your favorite internet book.
Ooh, touche.
So touché. There you have it.
Thank you. That is beautiful.
Isn't it?
Thank you. Appreciate that.
You're
well, go ahead. Let's see your segment here.
Well,
I'll get you back.
Okay, good. In terms of See You, See Me, I've been working on a video series at the University of Michigan, and the last of those has to do with real-time communications on the net. We have six videos in that series, and we conducted this interview with Kevin Hughes over the internet using See You, See Me. And we want to take a look at this provided courtesy of the Michigan Engineering Television Network and see what the interview looks like. Okay, we started our conversation with an old-fashioned telephone call, but we're going to hang up the phone and we're going to use See You, See Me now. So, here goes. We're speaking with Kevin Hughes, who works at Enterprise Integration Technologies in Menlo Park, California, and we're using See You, See Me to carry on the conversation. Hi, Kevin.
Hi, Rich.
Well, we seem to have pretty good sound coming this end. How am I coming through on your end?
Oh, there's a lag time of a few seconds, but you're coming through loud and clear.
Great. How long have you been fiddling with See You, See Me?
Pretty much since the early beta versions came out. I'd say about a year and a half, 2 years.
How many different people do you talk with over this mechanism?
Well, I don't really talk with anyone regularly, but I have bumped into friends all over the place. Probably half a dozen folks here and there, West Coast, East Coast, Hawaii, and so on.
Well, how often do you arrange the call in advance, as we did, and how often do you just sort of leave it enabled for people to call in?
Usually, our place is not open all the time for this kind of thing. Typically, I just am out browsing around, lurking on places, and sometimes I bump into folks I know, and when that happens, we start up a conversation, and there we go.
Uh-huh. Tell me about using CUCME for not just person-to-person type things, but also for carrying on real-time events. Like, I understand there's a TV station in Austin that you can plug into over CUCME.
Well, in terms of real-time events, I have seen a few very interesting ones. Some months ago, there was a very nice exhibit at the Exploratorium, which is a museum in San Francisco, that allowed people to come up to the camera and talk to other folks around the net. I think that was very successful. You could come in any time of the day and check out what people were doing. I've seen a few conferences online. Remember, there was an IBM conference on CUCME through a Windows machine, and because audio wasn't enabled then, the other person would be scribbling words on paper and showing it up to me. But we were still able to have a conversation nevertheless. When there's a will, there's a way, right?
Sure. So you do think this is a viable communications medium even as it exists today?
I mean, as it exists today, it's going to be more obvious as hardware and software gets better. Really is of a limit with video done for a decade into seriously seeing how people can collaborate over spaces like this.
Well, great.
Close to real time as can be shown on a screen.
Yep. Well, listen, Kevin, we want to thank you for your time and showing us what CUCME is all about. See you in Chicago.
See you there. In real time.
In real time. So long.
Goodbye.
And that concludes our CUCME demo.
Well, Chuck, what do you think?
I think that's really neat. I think a lot of people think that the internet is only for email and those kinds of things, and this kind of thing is only possible on telephone networks with real expensive equipment. But I think CUCME shows that it's possible to do that kind of stuff on the internet.
Now, of course, that's the kind of thing where in a couple of years we're going to look back and we're going to say this is pretty primitive. But today's CUCME makes very good use of the available bandwidth wherever you're going between point A and point B. We saw some breakup in the audio, and the video, of course, is slow scan. But overall, it does the best job it can over the link that it's got. And it's remarkably effective. You can do good stuff with it.
Tonight, I want to talk a little bit on a Tech Talk segment about a technique called M-Bone. And M-Bone is called, it's multicast for the network. And what multicast is intended to do is allow a program to be sent to as many computers or as few computers as necessary to get the information across the internet as efficiently as possible. The thing that got me interested in M-Bone was the fact that I was taking a look at what was on the M-Bone today, and all of a sudden I noticed that the NASA had Space Station Mir docking with the shuttle on. And so we started watching a little bit, and we noticed that the docking was coming up and the audio was coming across. What you're seeing right now is we just popped in a tape and started recording it. And so we're seeing here what was going on. Here we see the...
over the latches on the Cristal module docking interface, and so a structural hard mate
that
has
audio
been completed
quality
between the two
excellent.
Vehicles.
Yes.
Atlantis and Mir firmly locked together for the next 5 days.
You'll notice we're getting about 0.2 of a frame per second. M-Bone carefully meters how much data it actually moves, and when there's a lot of movement in the frame, you'll notice it. M-Bone really focuses, though, on getting the audio, and it sacrifices the video.
That's impressive.
Yeah, it's very interesting. And really, M-Bone really has to be considered an experiment. It's not really a production service. There's not really enough bandwidth in the internet to do heavy-duty M-Bone now. But we see many, many exciting experiments, and certainly something like the NASA shuttle mission is worthy of spending a little bit of internet bandwidth. So now I want to talk a little bit in more detail about how the M-Bone works, because it's a fascinating kind of a thing. As I said before, the M-Bone is what we call Internet multicast. The Internet originally was designed to handle point-to-point communication, much like the telephone system. There's many other communication forms. We have sort of broadcast, where we have one-to-many, or we have group communication, where we have a group talking together. The Internet is certainly experimenting with these forms of communication. And Rich mentioned CUCME as a group, possible group communication tool. Usually when we users look at the Internet, we just kind of think it's one big cloud. It's actually made up of many interconnected networks. What happens with M-Bone traffic is each network has what's called an M-Bone routers. And these routers all work together to communicate with each other and move the data most efficiently. So what you have here is this router in each physical location that's connected over a different network segment. And somewhere you have video that's being, or audio that's being originated, or other forms of communication. So when you start a multicast, and I'm showing this by the green, now this data is now flowing across this link. All of these routers are actually communicating rather regularly, not maybe every second or so, as to what information is up. So what will happen is a message will get sent out to every other router of the availability of this particular video feed. Now, if someone at a workstation decides, clicks on it, says, I would like to view that video, the video is now fed down that link. No video is fed down a link until someone wants the video to be sent. So now we've added a single workstation and the video is moving. Now someone else clicks and says, I would also like the video. So now the video is also sent to this workstation on the right. But you'll note that the video is still only sent once across the original link to save the bandwidth as much as possible. But it is being sent across these two links. Now say another person clicked and decided I would like to view it as well. At the same site, there is again no more data moved across the backbone, and the data is only moved across the local area network. We're trying to minimize the use of the backbone resources. And someone now dropped from it, said, I didn't want to watch that particular show, so we drop it. Now we're not moving the data at all. And this communication is done very carefully with these routers. Now we've added a third site, and the data moves across here. And so the M-Bone, all systems really know all the programs that are available, but no data is actually sent unless someone is watching the data. And if multiple subscribers are watching, the data is only sent once, and it's replicated at the end site by what's called the M-Bone router. So, some nifty tricks that they do in the M-Bone to make it work really well. First off, as Rich mentioned, the audio quality was very impressive. The M-Bone adapts automatically to the speed and the quality of the net connection. We were watching about 2 a.m. in the middle of the night, and we noticed we were getting 2 or 3 frames a second on the video. During the middle of the day, 9 o'clock, when they actually did the dock, we were getting about a half of a frame per second. So everything adapts, put together to make it work really well. Another thing it does is it prioritizes the audio. Video frames are dropped. We don't have to worry about video if the link is a little bit slow. And a neat thing about audio is there are a number of compression formats available for audio where you sacrifice quality and you get improved performance. And some of them actually work over a standard dial-up. You can get reasonable quality audio coming across compressed on a standard dial-up. So this kind of thing actually allows you to do group communication. I've actually gone on the M-Bone and noticed people having design reviews on the M-Bone. You can have private group communication or public group communication. And if you're real cool, you have public. And we actually listened in on some design reviews. And again, now at different locations, people communicate, and the data is only sent once across, say, this path here in the middle, even though there are multiple people. And in this mode, each person has both a speaker and a headset. And we've actually used this in some experiments, and it's quite impressive what you can do with a speaker and a headset. People jump in and shout, and it all works. It works very nicely. So in a summary, M-Bone is really an interesting experiment. It's hard to say that it's production yet, but this point-to-point network medium is expanded to add the multicast capability. Today, it's probably usable as an audio conference tool, but it may have applications in many areas, including distance learning, as long as we have sufficient network bandwidth. And so that's my tech talk for today. It's about M-Bone, and I think it's a really neat thing, and I think we're going to see more of this as the network capability improves.
This has been a busy month for NetNews. NetNews has been active in terms of internet stories in the newspapers, in TV coverage, and so forth. I want to begin with a couple of items from newspapers. First off, a case that's somewhat celebrated in the state of Michigan is the Jake Baker case, an undergraduate at the University of Michigan who was charged with conduct that was inappropriate because he posted a message to a Usenet news group about a classmate, and that message had some rather unsavory information in it. A federal court has decided that the charges, at least in federal court, against him are not valid and has thrown the case out. So far, Jake Baker is no longer a student at the University of Michigan, but his federal charges are no longer a problem for him. In other areas of conduct on the net, folks are very concerned about issues that have to do with sort of the seamier side of the internet. We seem to have a race among various newspapers and Time and Newsweek and ABC News on Nightline and everyone else to talk about the fact that there's some illicit or pornographic information out on the net. Here's an example from USA Today where they talk about the internet's seamy side. So we find that a lot of journalists are discovering this as an interesting story these days. In other news, the Justice Department has been looking at what Microsoft is up to in terms of building their network. Microsoft plans to have access for their network built right into Windows 95. Now, the other online services such as America Online and Prodigy are concerned about this because we expect tens of millions of Windows 95 users. With, say, 50 million users of this network, even if you had a low response rate, you could have many more customers than the other services have. For instance, by comparison, the largest service right now is America Online with 2.9 million subscribers. So far, Microsoft is claiming that the Justice Department is engaging in harassment. The Encyclopedia Britannica, which we have discussed on this program, has decided that their online presence should be offered through Time Warner. They've entered into a partnership where their online service will now appear on the Time Warner Pathfinder web service. Now, what's interesting about this is that their two indexes will be merged. For instance, if you do a search on the word Bosnia, you will not only be searching the content of Time magazine, you'll also be able to search the Encyclopedia Britannica. As more and more firms get involved in providing information on a commercial basis on the internet, people want to know how many folks are actually tuning in. So, for instance, the Hotwired service on the World Wide Web, which is based on content from Wired magazine, has entered into an arrangement with the Nielsen rating service. So we will have something similar to TV ratings, where we have sort of a third party that goes on and tells us how many folks are actually plugging in and looking at resources on the web. Recently, IBM Corporation acquired Lotus Corporation. And during that acquisition phase, they decided that the internet would be part of their strategy. They used tactics that had to do with using the internet for getting the word out, exactly what people wanted to know in terms of IBM's spin. So they got word out both for Lotus staff and for Lotus customers and for investors and others. They coordinated this effort with other PR moves. So while they were putting information out on the World Wide Web, they were putting out complementary information in other media. Netscape Communications Corporation has decided to go public. Their initial offering is going to have 3.5 million shares available to the public. The first quarter revenue in 95 for this company was $4.7 million. The company has 38 million shares outstanding, and that's after they were founded in March of 1994. The U.S. Senate has passed Senator Exon's bill, 84-6, and amendments to offer an alternative to the Exxon bill by Senator Leahy were rejected. Now, this bill would provide for severe sanctions against anyone who carries what's deemed to be indecent material on the internet. If you want to read more about the bill in terms of its text or analysis of the bill, go to the URL on the screen here, http://www.ctd.org, and you'll find further information. Newt Gingrich has decided that he's opposed to Senator Exxon's bill. On a cable TV show, he announced that it's clearly a violation of free speech, and it's a violation of the right of adults to communicate with each other. Furthermore, he says it's very badly thought out, and it's not very productive. Now, in terms of the Exxon bill and Gingrich's reaction to it, Chuck, we're moving out of news and into commentary here. You've known me for a number of years as a person of considerable moderation and equanimity when it comes to public statements. But I think the example of the Senate vote of 84-6 in favor of this bill we see the world's greatest deliberative body, as they like to call themselves, really exhibiting the behavior of a confederacy of dunces.
Well, I also think that this bill is very important, and I'm very concerned about it. The problem is that there are all kinds of things on the internet. There's much great good on the internet, and there's some bad stuff on the internet as well. I think one of the problems is for many years the internet has been adult world, and people have not bothered to hide their kinds of communication, and so it's a little obvious that what's going on at times. And I think if they'd hidden it all this time, people wouldn't be so concerned. And I think as we, as this thing evolves across a broader segment of society, things will change. But I don't think that the appropriate thing to do is to limit what can be done. I think it's a medium that's very important.
Let me give you a quick example of the media overkill on this. I heard about a foundation in Washington that was talking about children's resources available on the net. They were contacted by several members of the mass media and asked, will you be discussing pornography on the net? And they said, no, we're not. We're talking about useful, good resources that are out there. And no one from the mass media showed up as a result.
Today's internet interview is with Jim Isaacs of Digital Equipment Corporation. I've known Jim for many years. Rich mentioned early in the show that I work with the IEEE Computer Standards Organization and attend standards committee meetings. Jim is sort of one of my mentors in standards, and he was the chair of the committee when I first met him. He is now working on the National Information Infrastructure Standards, and he has an interesting and exciting perspective on the internet. And today we're going to take a look and hear what he has to say about the National Information Infrastructure.
The internet is a critical part of the information infrastructure for a couple of reasons. It demonstrates how the digital technology can be used and be used in an interactive way on a broad basis. And that's the first example we've really had of that that people can build on to understand how the new technologies can be used more effectively. Internet doesn't provide things currently such as video capabilities, real-time video at least, conferencing capabilities, although there are experiments in all these areas. And those are things that are also part of the information infrastructure that will be evolving. So the biggest challenge I think we face right now is we have a group of very different industries involved. The way the telephone system works and the way the telephone companies understand the transactions they do and the cable companies is quite different. One's broadcast oriented, one's switched and interpersonal, connect point to point oriented. And NII really is a merger of those concepts where we start having broad-based multimedia interaction between people on a switched basis, on a as you choose to connect basis. NII is going to have major impact on our society. In Europe, it's referred to as GIS, Global Information Society, because they've taken the understanding of how that's going to impact society and made that part of the discussion point. Certainly a concern that's been raised with internet, it's been raised with cable television, it's been raised with telephone services, especially 900 numbers, are things like, are there information sources that children should not have access to? Is there material out there that isn't appropriate? What do we do to control that? And I think one of the key things we need to understand is there's intelligence in the system on both ends. What that means is that the television set today really doesn't have the ability to stop something from coming in. You don't have that choice. And one thing I think we should demand of the information infrastructure will be the ability to say, no, I don't want to receive this kind of material, and simply block it from being received at a given set. Privacy is an interesting consideration in information infrastructure. Essentially, there's a recognition that people have some rights that need to be protected. You don't want, for example, people to be able to pick up your telephone calls or anything else you might transmit out across the system. Certainly, if you're making purchases, you'd like your credit card number to be protected, but perhaps also what you're purchasing. You don't want necessarily people to know that you're purchasing a car this week or you're purchasing certain types of clothing, because that would expose you to certain types of future solicitation. On the other hand, one of the ways to fund information infrastructure will be through advertising. And traditional advertising is very broad-based, car ad for everybody. On the other hand, you maybe want to sell the information that you have about your own purchasing interests in return for discounts on the cost of information infrastructure delivered to your home. And that's another opportunity that can be used to reduce costs at trade-off in terms of privacy. So it's a matter of personal choice. Hopefully, if you have the money, you can buy as private a connection as you want and not see a single ad. And if you want to get it free, you may have to give up some more information, watch some more advertising, maybe very focused advertising to exactly what you want to buy, and get the services for free. On information, information infrastructure, there's a lot of sources. The U.S. government is actually a key one. There's a URL that's been set up for the Information Infrastructure Task Force. That's www.iitf.doc, for Department of Commerce. And that organization has information both from the administration sources, various vision statements, but also a recent committee report called the Common Ground Report from industry, setting some time frames and some objectives in terms of delivery of services that I think will give people a good understanding of what we're trying to get done.
Well, Rich, what'd you think of that?
I thought it was interesting. The most important word I heard in there was the discussion of choice, the idea of tailoring the infrastructure for the individual and for what the individual wants and needs.
Right. I think that's a big part of the national information infrastructure and how it's different from the Internet. Of course, it's the merging of all these technologies coming together, cable, telephone, and the Internet technology. But I think almost as important is the social impact of the national information infrastructure. And I think the good thing is the social aspects of this has been part of the discussion as pretty much from the very beginning. And I think it's sort of the Internet is this thing and we've discovered it, and the national information infrastructure is going to sort of turn it into something that society can make better use of, I think.
But whatever happens, I think it's fair to say the Internet is the prototype for many of the things we'll see.
I think so. I agree with that.
We've allocated plenty of time tonight to do a little bit of net surfing, and we want to cruise around the net with reckless abandon. We're using a slightly different environment right now. We're actually running under Unix on this Intel PC, and we're running a version of Netscape that runs under Unix.
Yes, we're using the free BSD operating system. There are many operating systems out there. Windows is one operating system. You may have heard of an operating system called OS2. That's the one the nuns talk about that Rich has mentioned before. And this is an operating system that has been developed and is freely available, and it's running Unix. But we're still using Netscape, and so some things may look a little unfamiliar to you, and some things may look more familiar, like typically Netscape. The first page I want to go to is I want to visit ESPN again. We've talked about ESPN before, and we just sort of showed it for a very brief point. But myself, I began to use ESPN a little more after the show. And what I found was the Detroit Red Wings were in the Stanley Cup playoffs, and I'd never made it to in time to watch most of the television shows. So what I found was I was using ESPN on the Internet to track the Stanley Cup playoffs. And now that playoffs are over and all we have is Major League Baseball up, but what they do here at ESPN, and I'm not exactly sure how they do it, but this stuff is up to date all the time. They must have people with portable computers sitting at some of these sporting events. And so what we're seeing here is we're seeing Major League Baseball scoreboard. And it should be coming here in a moment. And what we'll see is this is up to the minute. And sometimes you'll see games in progress. You'll see games in a third and fourth inning. And it's coming.
Actually, you mentioned the idea of being live on the floor of whatever event you're at and connecting back. The Nando people that we talked about in the last episode, the Raleigh News and Observer folks, have done that sort of thing. They'll have people with a digital camera at the arena and a cellular modem, so they
cool.
can transmit the stuff live back to the newsroom for posting on the Internet.
So here we got the American League. This is up to the minute. Right now, Baltimore's at Toronto. Baltimore's ahead 0-5. And it's at the bottom of the seventh. Then you'll see that these
Baltimore's
are...
Baltimore's ahead 0-5.
Oh, sorry.
No wonder you always win when we compete.
Change the game. Okay, National League. And what I did is I'd want to watch the game, and I would just sit here, and I'd go hit the reload button every single time I wanted to see the new score. So I think this is really interesting. And then the even more interesting thing that happened is... You know, after the Wings lost, of course, in Stanley Cup Finals, which is really a sad thing for us folks in Michigan, what they would have is they would actually have two or three feature articles here within minutes after the end of the game. So here we have Murray one hit away from 200. Game still in progress. Blah, blah, blah. In the second inning, he struck out in the fourth and the fifth innings. Keep your eyes glued to ESPN for updates throughout the game. I mean, I think this is exciting. I think this is different. Yep. I think this is neat. And it allows people to be a sports fan who may not necessarily have the time to be a sports fan. Because I was able to keep track of the Red Wings sitting there at work. I think the next thing is we're going to start seeing the pictures and little clips and the highlight films as the thing is happening. So I think that's really a blast. So I think that's really neat. So I'm glad we had a little bit of time to go into this in a little bit more detail. Let's go find another, comics. Comic strips have really been something that the web has been fascinated. Certainly a lot of the comic strips have a technical aspect to them, say a comic strip like Dilbert. And what this is the first that I'm aware of an organization. It's called United Media. And what they do now is, I believe these are now professional paid columnists. And and so we can take a look at, say, Dilbert, which is a very computer nerd-oriented column.
Comic.
Comic, yes.
Now, Dilbert is something that is definitely in the big time, and it's geared towards computer nerds, perhaps. And here's a joke that's definitely, we've got some computer terms in here.
Oh, got different operating systems. Yeah, okay, the Holy Wars begin.
Yeah.
The Mac users, yeah. So,
and if you look carefully on the strip, if you'll point here, you'll see we should be able to find his email address right here.
Oh, right. Right
there, so Scott. So far as I know, Scott Adams is the first comic artist, cartoonist, to put his email address right in the middle of the strip.
Yeah, Frank and Ernst did that, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Frank and Ernst did that. A comic strip that's real interesting is one called Dr. Fun, and Dr. Fun is done by a fellow named David Farley out of Chicago. Let's see if I can find Dr. Fun here. Oh, there he is. The neat thing about Dr. Fun is very early on, I'm not sure exactly when it started, David started writing Dr. Fun on the internet. It was not a print media. It was purely an internet comic. And so Dr. Fun, I assume David Farley's now making some money on this, and I was thinking about driving down to Chicago and taking a look at Dr. Fun and interviewing David about this, but I believe he's now making money, and I think this is an interesting thing that he broke into the business of comics by putting it up on the internet, developing a following, and then I believe that I wouldn't be surprised if they came to him. So here's today's Dr. Fun.
That's definitely gone on. It's also gone on in the area of internet books. I know of authors who got their books published and without ever sending a proposal in, editors saw it on the net and said, hey, you ought to turn this into a book.
So here's today's Dr. Fun, introducing the all-day milk dud.
That one I halfway get. I have to admit that a lot of the Dr. Fun stuff, I just stare at it, and it's worse than Far Side. You go, what
well, it,
is
it does remind me a lot of the Far Side cartoon, but it's pretty neat stuff. And I look at this and I say this United Features is going to, I believe, be a good commercial mechanism. And we'll probably see some advertising in here. Here we'll just point out the Dr. Fun cartoons average 100K in size. Viewers with slow links may wish to get some coffee, of course. Coffee's a running theme on our show. But you'll notice how quickly that came down on our wonderful connection we have here in the studio. That's very nice and very quick. That's as quick as it is at where I work. So right now the link is running pretty well. Let's go back.
Boy, you shouldn't have said that.
No, sorry. Take that. We'll have to edit that out in post-production that I said. Knock on forehead. Let's see. Where do you want to go next?
Well, I don't know. You want to cruise to Batman Forever, maybe?
Sure. This is part of the movie that's now here. and the idea is this, much like you said with IBM, this is part of their marketing.
And they put all kinds of clips out there.
I unfortunately don't have a QuickTime viewer configured.
You remember earlier in the show we were talking about Netscape isn't able to show you all the different file types it wants on its own. It needs the assistance of a helper application every once in a while. And on this particular Unix setup, we haven't set up all the little helpers we need, so we won't be able to actually view the clips.
Right.
But this gives you a flavor of some of the stuff
here,
that's out there.
This would bring down probably 6 to 10 megabytes of material, and then we'd be able to view it.
Now, earlier in the show, we saw a QuickTime clip from the show. When I was on my trip to Montreal recently and visiting Le Café Electronique, I showed them the homepage for Internet TCI so they'd understand what I was up to, why I was there visiting these folks. And they were connected over a 28.8 modem connection. And they saw one of those QuickTime clips of the show, and they said, well, we're not going to click on this because it would be literally 4 hours to get it down over our modem connection.
Hey, you mention Nando all the time,
yeah.
The News and Observer. Let's show people how we might use a search engine to go find Nando.
Okay.
Let's use the Netscape Communications search engine. Search engines are a very popular part of the Internet. And what they allow you to do is, instead of having to happen upon things, they allow you to figure out in advance, or someone has actually gone and found things for us. So here is a search engine that is one of the buttons, actually, that you get for Netscape. And I'm going to put in here Nando.
If you type it right, we might actually find it.
Okay. Nando, News and Observer. So I'm going to run a query. Now, what's happening here is this is being sent across the network to a system that has looked over the web before, and it's found a URL already on our behalf. So, News and Observer, Nando. We'll click on this. Now, it comes back in the form of a web page with URLs all built in. So, are we here? Is this what this is?
This could be it.
Let's
see what the URL is for it, for that very first one.
Oh.
There you go.
Okay.
Bingo, you're there.
Okay.
Now, as it happens, we could use a different strategy that we've talked about before. If you tried plugging in www.nando.net, you'd jump there. And the key here is you might have guessed it was www.nando.com instead of .net.
Right.
So the search engine was useful in this case.
So here's some of the Nando stuff, news and information, business news, Nando Next.
And the Durham Bulls ballpark preview.
Of course. We
Lots of
there.
Good sports information.
We were there before.
Okay.
Okay. Well, I guess that's about all the time we have for Internet search.
That's pretty good surfing.
Yep.
Pretty gnarly.
Yep. I think we had a good time. Basically, I think we had a good show. Anything that you want to sort of summarize?
Well, gee, I can't imagine. I mean, we've got the global Internet. How can I summarize that, Chuck?
Okay, well, I guess we encourage people to contact us on the net. The email address will come up on your screen. We encourage people to take a look at our homepage and let us know what you think.
We definitely want to hear from other viewers. Send us some email. I've discovered my next-door neighbor watches the show. And we've received half a dozen other pieces of email. But let's hear from all of you folks. Do you like the show? Where do you want us to go? Tell us where to surf and so forth.
Take it easy. See you next show.
So long.